Over the ocean, moonlight still on the sea. Will the waves' gentle motion bring my baby back to me? And the stardust sprinkles the morning. Venus fades from my side. Will my love be returning? Like the sun to brighten up my life. And as day breaks over the ocean, moonlight still on the sea, I pray the waves' gentle motion will bring my baby to me. Stars are to shine, baby, you will always have my devotion. I'll love you pretty, baby, till the end of time. And as day breaks over the ocean, moonlight's still on the sea, I'll pray the waves' gentle motion will bring my baby to me.
Thank you. Arbor.
So you can see how far away it is.
Close to home, because our door is only two doors away. Right here, number 6369, our sign, our meal's about to fall off, and we gotta get the key out. How we get in the door. Then we push hard. Oh, that didn't work. It would help if I used the right side of the card. There. And in our room. We are in our room. Precious little Bunny Rabbit. Carol's bed. Our couch.
A little wet here, isn't it? great. You can see the Charles River. The Charles River separates Boston from Cambridge. So everything on the other side is Cambridge. We are currently in Boston. After the Boston Tea Party in 1773, Great Britain basically said, that's it. No more autonomy for the American colonies. They shut Boston down. They installed a curfew. There was martial law. There was a siege. Nothing was going in or out. And so what you ended up with was the British Army in Boston proper and the colonial militias everywhere else. So we are currently, as a crow flies, maybe 12 to 15 miles outside of Boston. But if you were here in 1775, this would be kind of the hotbed of political unrest and activism, and our political leaders, John Hancock and Samuel Adams, who were originally Boston-based, had to flee to Lexington, which is where we are right now, because it wasn't safe for them to be in Boston anymore because they were wanted for treason. So that's kind of setting the stage for the story that we're going to be telling. So April 18, 1775, Paul Revere gets word that the British Army is going to be leaving Boston and going to Concord, Massachusetts. And in order to get from Boston to Concord, you have to pass through Lexington. And he knew that Hancock and Adams were in Lexington and probably would want to know that the British Army was going to be coming by pretty much right where they were. So he went on his famous midnight ride from Boston to Lexington, warning Hancock and Adams that the British Army was on their way. He was not the only rider that night, but he is, of course, the most famous because of the poem, The Revere's Ride. Listen, my children, and you shall hear of the midnight ride of Paul Revere. He was successful in getting to Lexington and alerting Hancock and Adams, and it set off this huge network of people alerting the militias that were out here that it was time to assemble and come gather because there was going to be, there could potentially be a battle. Or not a battle, there was at least going to be about 800 British troops leaving Boston and going out to Concord. And the reason they were coming out to Concord was because they heard that the colonists had been stockpiling ammunition and supplies. Enough supplies to feed and arm an entire army. But we just didn't know when exactly the British troops were going to mobilize and leave Boston and go in full force out to Concord. So the line one of by land, two of by sea was the signal lantern. Two of by sea meaning are the troops going to leave Boston over the Charles River, or are they going to go down the one road that existed that connected Boston? Lexington.
The buildings themselves were here to witness what happened during the battle. And so you have some men drinking in the tavern, waiting for things to happen. And about 4:30 in the morning, they hear the sound of drums, and 70 men gather on Lexington Common as 800 British soldiers march in formation towards them. So, you can probably imagine who won this battle. It wasn't even really a battle, it was over in 15 seconds. After a few seconds, shots ring out. There's a volley, meaning back fire back and forth. No quarters given to fire, just people firing at one another. And when the dust clears a few moments later, 8 men lay dead. All 8 men were from the Lexington militia. There were no fatalities on the British side. And one of those men who died was Jonathan Harrington. He was mortally wounded. He made it back to his front porch and died in the arms of his wife, who was watching this whole thing. The British Army, this wasn't even a stop for them, really. They were aiming for Concord, so they just kept going. And it took them a few hours to get to Concord, so there were a lot more men gathered and waiting for them when they got to Concord than there were here. But this was officially the first shock of the American Revolution.
This is the Harrington House that she was referring to, where he died on the front porch with his wife holding him.
Orchard House is where Louise May Alcott grew up. She's most famous for writing Little Women, which is semi-autobiographical. It's based on her own experiences as a child living in that house with her 3 sisters. She comes.
This is Concord, the Battle of Concord. And that's the North Bridge. Grave of the British soldiers who died at this battle. They were buried where they died. The home of they witnessed the battle right in from that house. North Bridge. Statue of the Minuteman. They had to be ready at any minute.
This is their own army. The British Army is their own army. These are all British subjects. He yelled out after his men were killed and wounded. He said, "Fire, fellow soldiers! For God's sake, fire!" They killed 2 British subjects. So there are the number. But both sides, these are British.
Also just the buildings are dispersed throughout the city, so sometimes you get to Harvard and people.
the girls went to Radcliffe, the men went to Harvard. Now, of course, it's all integrated. And behind that is the Divinity School. All right, so yeah, get into your right lane. And then we're gonna, from the right lane, turn left down this, like, kind of rotary. All right, so straight ahead, this is Harvard Yard. All of these brick buildings straight ahead of us. Everything behind those buildings and everything behind those buildings is Harvard Yard, which is basically the quad. You're gonna bear right here. And we're gonna go under the overpass. So, your first year, if you're an undergraduate, you have to live in Harvard Yard. So a lot of these brick buildings that you see to your right are dorms. You're gonna see Memorial Hall, which was, it looks like a church, but it was actually built as a memorial to the soldiers from Harvard, the Harvard students and alums who fought and died during the Civil War. The whole, this part of it, the back part of it, is actually the dining hall. That is the freshman dining hall. It looks like Hogwarts inside. And then the taller part of the building, which kind of looks like the chapel, that is Sanders Theater, so it's a theater inside. Harvard. You can kind of see